senior citizens. Madam has conducted several awareness campaigns and workshops, especially for women from different age groups on various topics related to women's health. Madam, I feel we are fortunate enough to have you today for this session and sharing your expertise and your views on women's health. Ma'am, once again, on behalf of Gujarat Research Societies, Hansraj Jivandas College of Education, our principal, Dr. Anita Swami, ma'am, the entire HJCE faculty, and the participants here, I extend a heartfelt welcome to you, ma'am. And over to you. The session is now, ma'am, yours. You can take home. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. Thank you, Archana, ma'am, for this wonderful introduction. So I would like to thank you heartily because of you, I got an opportunity to now interact with all your students. So this is something I always eagerly look forward to. Thank you so much. Can we begin? Should I share the screen?
Yes, yes, ma'am. Yes, definitely. Participants, we request you, if you have any questions, please put it in the chat box, and this is going to be an interactive session, so be ready for it. Okay. Yes, ma'am, you can start, please.
Okay. So good afternoon, all young ladies. So in the company of young ladies, we will also start feeling younger, right? So that is a good thing. Okay. So today's topic is going to be about addiction and how it is going to affect our health as women. So we don't want to fall prey to addictions. So that is what we are going to do. So what I'm planning to do is, I don't want to stop with telling you that, you know, we should not get into addiction. We also need to talk about what are the good things we need to do, how we can look at wellness, right? So how we can live well, how we can have a healthy life. So that is what we are going to cover in the second part. So the first part is going to be on addiction, and second part is going to be on wellness. Why this is not moving? Okay. So now first, let us talk about what is health. So we should know what is health in the first place. So let us have a small poll. So Pallavi ma'am is going to help us here with all the poll questions. So we are going to have a quick poll now.
Yes, ma'am. The poll is open now. Participants, you must be... everybody started. Ma'am, 71 participants have voted. There are a few more who need to vote. We have total 95 attendees. Yes, those who have not voted, please vote.
After lunch is also a sleepy time, right? Good, but so far everybody is doing really good.
Yes, there are 74 people who have voted. So should I end the poll, ma'am, now?
Yeah, I think at 2 minutes we can end it.
Okay.
We still have few more seconds, so we can just wait for a while. Okay, I think you can end the poll now.
Yeah. Yes.
Very nice. Out of the 78 people who have voted, everyone is aware that what is health? It is not just merely the absence of disease, but it means wellness, both physically, psychologically, emotionally, socially. Well done, girls. You all rock. Superb. Okay, so now this is the way we are beginning. So with a good awareness as to what is health, right? So you are all aware of what is health. Okay, so now we are going to come to our topic. So what is addiction? So, you know, this is the, you know, definition of addiction, which is it's a compulsive, chronic, either it can be physiological or a psychological need. And there is a habit-forming substance. So we all know what a substance is. It can be alcohol, it can be drugs, or it can be a behavior or activity also, which can be harmful for our physical well-being, psychological well-being, or it can have social effects. And on withdrawal of that, it causes specific symptoms. Like there can be anxiety, there can be irritability, nausea, like that. So then we say we are in a state of being addicted. Okay. So addiction clearly says that it need not be only a substance. It can be other behaviors or activity also. Okay. So what are the common addictions which we know of? So we all know that tobacco, use of tobacco is an addiction. Use of alcohol is an addiction. And use of drugs, which we commonly call substance abuse. So that is also an addiction, right? Okay. So what would be the long-term effects? We all know that if you are consuming alcohol, it is going to have immediate effect in the body, right? Because the stomach lining will immediately, quickly start absorbing the alcohol. Quickly it enters the bloodstream. So as the blood level of alcohol increases, it reaches your brain. You know, there is the cerebellum in the brain, which is essential for balance, and it moves to all the areas of the brain. It gives a sense of high. So that is how, you know, people get addicted to alcohol, because it gives a false sense of well-being, a false sense of self-esteem, which is all immediate. So that is the immediate pleasure of alcohol, right? So along with that, it can also cause inflammation in the, you know, stomach immediately. There are, you know, people who may throw up blood, or, you know, these kind of things can also happen. And I want here to very clearly mention that as compared to men, women's body is much more susceptible to alcohol. So even if the same quantity of alcohol, even for a lesser quantity of alcohol, which the lady may consume, there can be more stronger impact in the body. So women feel much more intoxicated with alcohol with smaller doses. Blood levels of alcohols are higher, and it reach higher levels quickly, and they take longer to get metabolized. So to hangover, to come over the hangover, it takes longer for women. So it is not that women are less powerful as compared to men, but in terms of the physical dimensions, so the women's body responds very differently to alcohol as compared to men. And there are also long-term effects, like there is going to be hormonal imbalance. So if you are consuming alcohol regularly, you may observe that you are missing periods and you start getting high blood pressure or stroke. And we know that alcohol causes damage of the liver. So people who are consuming alcohol are more likely to develop cirrhosis or damage to the liver. And cancers of the breast, mouth, esophagus, liver, colon, everything is common. And it can also reduce your intellectual functions, like, you know, difficulty in remembering things. You know, these things can be there. And the most important thing is the psychological effect. There can be anxiety, there can be stress, there can be guilt, and relationship problems. So a lot of other social issues are also there, you know, associated with consumption of alcohol. Okay, so now we want to move further. So women have different phases in life. So, you know, now you are all young ladies, say around 21, 22, 23, this age group. Very soon as we get married, we get pregnant. So we enter another phase of life. So what do you all think about alcohol consumption in pregnancy? Let us have a small poll. Pallavi ma'am.
A poll is open for everybody.
I think we can stop at 1 minute only, no? Or 1.5 minutes. We can give 1.5 minutes.
75 participants have voted right now. So I'm stopping poll now. We have 80 participants who have voted.
Yes. So this is again fabulous. You all are showing that, you know, you are more aware of, you know, the ill effects of consuming alcohol in pregnancy. So out of 81 people, only one person has said that, yes, we can consume small quantities of alcohol during pregnancy. All of you have said that you should not consume alcohol. Yes, you should not consume alcohol during pregnancy. Even if it is small quantities, it is not permissible. So we need to understand why, right? Because in some cultural practices, it is there occasionally to have a, you know, one small drink. They say that it is admissible or it is permissible in pregnancy also, but it is not. So the reason being that when a woman's body will get intoxicated much earlier with a particular dosage of alcohol, you just imagine a growing fetus who is not yet fully formed. The nervous system is not fully formed. The liver and the kidneys, which are the main organs which are going to metabolize and excrete the harmful chemicals, they are not fully formed. Don't you think they will be much more vulnerable to damage? Yes, they are much more vulnerable to damage because of the effect of alcohol. So we can never give clearance that, you know, this much amount of alcohol can be consumed safely. So there is no safe prescription for consuming alcohol, because women who are consuming alcohol, they can have what is called the fetal alcohol syndrome. We call it the fetal alcohol syndrome. So where there is cleft lip or cleft palate. So you can see in this picture above, this young baby has got a cleft lip or palate. These kind of birth defects happen along with that small sized head, microcephaly we call it, where the brain development is not well, because the baby in the utero has been subjected to high levels of alcohol, so which did not allow the nerve cells to grow well. So it can cause intellectual impairments. So you know, this is called a, and along with that, because of this, there will be developmental delay. The child does not develop normally. So it becomes a long-term health sequelae in the family. Along with that, there are higher risks of preterm deliveries, small for dates babies, that is very low birth weight babies, right? So these things are common. So the health risk to the baby is going to be a long-term sequelae. Those babies will not be able to, when they grow up, they may not be able to walk or talk on time. They may not be able to learn things the way other babies are learning. So it is going to be a big, big, big issue. So we have to remember that there is no safe level of alcohol that can be consumed ever in pregnancy. Even during the breastfeeding phase, it is advisable not to consume alcohol because alcohol easily moves through the breast milk. So it is like feeding alcohol to growing baby. So there are women who are already addicted to alcohol, who cannot stop alcohol. So those mothers, they have to reduce, you know, giving breast milk to the babies, or they can give breast milk. After that, they will take alcohol and they will not give breast milk to the baby till the time the blood levels of alcohol goes down. So which means most of them may not breastfeed their babies. And we all know that breastfeeding is so very important. So it is the best thing to avoid consumption of alcohol even in the breastfeeding phase. Right? Okay. So the next, addiction we can discuss is about tobacco. So tobacco, there are, you know, commonly in India, at least there are two forms in which tobacco is being used. Either it is used in the form of cigarette or a bidi, or a non-smoking form, a smokeless tobacco use, which is the chewing tobaccos. So which is very common. If you see in Maharashtra also, the percentage of smoking is lesser as compared to the percentage of smokeless tobacco. That is, chewing on tobacco is much, much more common in the state of Maharashtra, right? So if we see, this is based on the, 2016 to 2017 census, that only 2% of women in India, this is India census, 2% of India, 2% of women are smokers. But if you see, 12.8% of them are consuming tobacco, or, you know, that kind of chewing tobacco. So tobacco chewing is practiced. Many times women have that feeling that that is not harmful. We may consider smoking as very harmful. So, you know, especially for women, smoking is a taboo in many places. But when it comes to chewing on tobacco, it is accepted, because we see everybody in our area, you know, chewing on tobacco, spitting. So, or, you know, they are, you know, using other forms of tobacco, which is crushed and put in the mouth. So that is more readily accepted in our society. But any form of tobacco consumption, whether you smoke the tobacco or chew the tobacco, the effects are the same. Different organs get affected in different, in order. But every part of the body is going to get affected with the consumption of tobacco, right? Okay. So there is one more interesting thing which I wanted to share with all of you. So you, if you are not a smoker, you know, this is especially for smoke exposure, because when somebody is smoking the cigarette, there is going to be nicotine, which is getting, you know, released. So, and it gets absorbed in the airways, and that is why nicotine is what is bad in the tobacco, right? So if you are a secondhand smoker, so then also we are going to get the effects of nicotine. And this study is also very clearly showing that it is not that we are getting exposed to secondhand smoke in the public places or in the restaurants. More than that, maximum is happening at home. Nearly 40% of exposure is happening at home. So if you are a lady, you're a non-smoker, but somebody in your family is smoking, you know, either the father, brother, husband, son, anyone, or other family members is smoking, and it's not necessary that all the time they are smoking inside in your presence. You are not there in the room, they are smoking, and later on you enter the room, the smoke remains in the air. You are still vulnerable. So it is very important for you to curtail smoking of the other members of the family for your health. You want to know how this is going to affect your health, right? Okay. So whether it is actively smoking or passively smoking, when you are consuming, you know, tobacco or smoke, you know, this is going to give all these things. The immediate things you will see, you know, which are women related specifically, you know, women related ones, there can be irregularity in your periods. Periods can become very painful. If you are, you know, looking at expanding your family, you're married, trying to have children, you may not be finding it very easy to conceive. And after having conceived, because mothers, pregnant ladies who are exposed to tobacco smoke, the placenta, you know, the placenta is the organ which is supplying nourishment to the baby. It forms the link between the mother and the baby. The placenta shrinks because with the influence of nicotine, all the blood vessels will shrink. Then they don't supply proper blood to the baby. The baby cannot grow well. So low birth weight, stillbirth babies. See, these are all things which can happen. And there can be inadequate breast milk supply because of the effect of nicotine. This holds good even for secondhand smoking. So if you are married and you are planning to have a baby and if your husband is a smoker, this is good time to encourage your husband to quit smoking so that there will be better outcomes for the growth of your baby, right? So these are all very important. We always think that if I should, my pregnancy should be good, I should not smoke. It's not just me. Even my husband should not smoke. If I have a father-in-law or father in the house, brother, brother-in-law, nobody should smoke in the house for the well-being of the child, right? So see how it can have a long-term implication, not just on our health, but on the babies which we bring forth to the world. So is it not our responsibility to ensure that we have a safe environment for ourselves as well as for our babies? We should. Right. So apart from this, you know, we all know that tobacco can cause cancers. So cancer can happen in all parts of the body, especially all through the way where these, you know, the tobacco reaches, like the esophagus, the stomach, the colon, the liver. It can cause uterine cancers and it can also cause osteoporosis. Right. So all these things are the effects of tobacco. Okay. So now that you understand how bad tobacco is, so let us go for the third point.
Yes, ma'am, and I've started the poll. Nikamija madam, 80 participants have participated in the poll.
Yes, I can also see it is showing in the screen. It's really nice to see the polling. I think at 1.5 minutes we can stop the poll. Okay. All right. See, this is now interesting. So out of the 82 participants, 76 of you, that is 93%, have said that you have to stop smoking as soon as possible. That's fantastic. So that is what we need to do, right? But out of them, 7 people have said that when you're planning pregnancy, we should stop smoking, right? So I want to give few reasons why you need to stop as soon as possible and not when planning pregnancy. Because nicotine, when it has an effect, it can also have an impact on our ovaries, on the eggs they are producing. So, you know, it causes poor quality eggs. So poor quality, see, for and if you are stopped smoking, and after few months only, slowly the egg quality starts getting little better, right? And it can sometimes cause some irreversible damage in the ovaries. So then their ability to produce good quality eggs may also deteriorate. So, you know, once you understand that, you know, it can have an effect on your fertility, the more earlier you stop smoking or, you know, quit tobacco, the more better chances of getting good quality eggs and the ability of the ovaries to make good eggs, so that fertility will be good. It is not just about having babies, but it is also about having healthier babies. So if they are already damaged, then even later on when you quit smoking, you may not be able to, you know, have healthier babies. You know, the possibility can reduce, which we don't want. And women in the reproductive age, they are like, you know, you are the future. You are the people who are going to bear the future generations. So if you want our future generations to be good, healthy, so the young women of today should have better health, free from any kinds of addictions, so that we will have a good experience, you know, when we have our babies. Okay, right. So now, so we know that we should not consume tobacco. So tobacco consumption or smoking, it can again cause a lot of problems during conception, and it can cause, you know, small for dates, babies, and it can cause sudden infant death. So especially for smoking mothers, if the mother is a smoker, or, you know, then the baby, it is unsafe for the baby to be in the same room, because the very young and soft lungs of the baby can get quickly affected by the nicotine from the mother's breath, and it can cause sudden infant death, right? So these are all the multiple things which we need to be aware of. And even in pregnancy, there can be more complication. We have already discussed how the placenta can shrink. It can also cause the placenta to detach earlier, which can cause overbleeding, which can risk the life of both the mother and the infant. And it can also give rise to a lot of birth defects, cleft lip, cleft palate. These are all things which are common. So, you know, it is very, very important that we, you know, get rid of addictions and ensure that you have a smoke-free environment for yourself and for your baby also later on. Okay. So the next in the list is substance abuse. So, or what we popularly call the drug addictions, right? So out of all the illicit drug users, nearly 42% are women. So it is a big number. It's a really a big number. And, you know, these figures I've given based on the article, you know, which I have quoted here. So this is from the Department of Psychiatry and National Drug Dependence Treatment Center, AIIMS, New Delhi. So they have put forth some very interesting facts which I wanted to share. See, I'm not going to talk about which drug, what it will cause, no. So we know that drugs, any form is bad. So there is no second thought about it. We need to understand what goes before taking to drugs, or what goes with taking to drugs, so that we know how to be careful, right? So they are saying that, you know, in the adolescent age, that is the time when people get more curious, so they are experimenting with it. But with age, boys, they take less of they slowly they reduce. You know, the number of boys who are getting abused with drug, they are reduced. But with girls, it is not happening. If they have started taking drugs in the teens, they are not able to get over that. So it becomes much more habit forming for girls. So there are some factors which they say is the reason. So the one is the environmental factor, like, you know, environment where somebody else in the family or friend circle, they are taking to drugs, then they are getting more pulled towards drugs. Or there could be, the genetic factor is for women is that women have the much more prone to getting the dependency. So whether it is drugs or alcohol, dependency for it to go away, you know, more to do with the genetic makeup of women, where we are more emotional, more attached to things. So it can happen that with drugs also, the attachment could be more, that it is very hard to give it up. So it is very, very important. So relapses, they say, are much more common in women as compared to men. So it is much more essential for us to be more careful about getting into these kind of addictions, right? Plus, there are other comorbid factors, like, you know, women who have anxiety disorders, or, you know, who are rape victims or victims of domestic violence or sexual abuse, or having depressive disorders, where drugs are used as a coping strategy. So now we have to understand that when there are other stress factors, so, you know, we need to look at other coping strategies, more healthier coping strategies, like exercise or fitness, or, you know, getting involved in some other activities which are more, you know, suitable to us, rather than getting into, these negative influences, because it is much more harder for women to come out of addictive behavior. So, see, whatever be the kind of addiction, whether it is alcohol, tobacco, or any kind of drug use, there are a lot of health consequences. So there is something called the telescoping effect. So what we mean by telescoping effect is, say, in a telescope, what happens? What is very far, like you see the stars, the galaxies, they come closer. You know, we can see them in a close range. The same way, the telescoping effect of health means what you see as a distant thing. Oh, I will age only at the age of 80. My skin will wrinkle only after 70. I will develop diabetes only after 60. All these things come very close. So that is what is called the telescoping effect of health deterioration. So the health will deteriorate much faster with all these addictions. So, and there is also increased risk of sexually transmitted diseases, and there is increased risk of sexual violence because of the vulnerability, right? Plus, there are legal, familial, and social consequences also. Like people who are into drug peddling and all, so they are getting into some kind of legal issues. Nearly 20% women, you know, may get into some legal issues. There is a risk of imprisonment. 44% women have reported they have been imprisoned because of these kind of drug peddling activities. They may be trading on sex so that they can get access to drugs or to alcohol, you know, those kind of things. And see, in our societies, it is still accepted if a man is alcoholic, if a man is a chain smoker, but it is still not accepted if a woman is an alcoholic or a chain smoker. So there is less of social support. So women are more likely to lose their jobs, be homeless, not getting family support. And more women are more likely to be disengaged from communities. So, you know, these are all factors which we need to consider. And even in the family, their own family may reject them. There may be harsh treatment. There may be more violence, both physical, verbal abuses will be there. More sexual abuse can happen within the home also because of, you know, all these addictions, right? So this is One, this is the very important reason why, you know, we need to avoid getting into any kind of addictions. And in case, you know, you have developed any of these habits, it is very essential to take help. Take help as soon as possible so that you can come out of it and, you know, start having a more healthier lifestyle. Because in the younger age group, all the health consequences, we said, are all reversible. As we age, as we have more years of addictions, then most of them get irreversible. So we have to take action when things are more reversible. Okay. So these are the common addictions. Do you know of any other addictions? So please use the chat box. So there are some other addictions also, which we may be hearing these days. So anything else which you have come across? I'm curious to know. Yes, technology addiction. Yes.
Yes.
Shopping addiction. Anupriya says shopping addiction. Yes, very true.
So Anupriya, is it just window shopping or in true sense shopping addiction?
True sense. Cleanliness addiction. Yes. Cleanliness addiction. Soft drinks. Online shopping addiction. Okay. Caffeine. Eating junk. The urge to check phone. Yes. Addiction of a person. Mean love? Pet addiction. I think it may not be an addiction. Mobile gadgets, yes. If you meant mobiles as the pets, then yes. True pets are good. Social media addiction, yes. Junk food, yes. OCD, yes. See, OCD is all they consider them more under neuropsychological conditions. Gaming addiction, yes, very true. Chocolate addiction, yes. Games. So all games means online games, right? So if you are wanting to play basketball or badminton, that is not addiction. If you want to do games on this thing, then it is yes. Makeup. Okay, makeup addiction. Okay. So many new additions to addictions, right? So now we understand that anything in excess is not a good thing. So now you just think of, you go back to what we discussed about addictions. So it is either a substance or a behavior or, some action which we compulsively feel like doing it again and again. And to the point that you cannot carry out your daily activities, what you're supposed to be doing. Like we are not able to focus on our studies. If it comes in the way of taking care of ourselves, taking care of the family, then we say it is definitely addiction. Okay, so let us see some of the common addictions. Screen addiction. Right. So many of you have said gadget addiction, mobile screen addiction. So what is it about screen? Because now they, a lot of research they are doing, they say that, you know, the blue light, which is coming from the screens. So these are all some neurotoxins and it can alter the melatonin levels. So melatonin is one enzyme in our body, which gives us the sleep cycles. So there are many studies which say that people who are more on the mobile phones, they say that the moment they go to bed, they take 1.5 hours before they can fall asleep. So 1.5 hours, imagine. So if you go to bed at 11 o'clock, you are still watching the screen till 12:30 before you can fall asleep. So this is bad. Because this will affect the melatonin levels and it can cause many things, like, you know, it can cause depression and lack of sleep, won't be able to concentrate, and ability to remember things, ability to do accurate work, ability to drive, you know, to think clearly, everything is going to get affected. And it can also give rise to overeating, so it can cause obesity risk, especially the, you know, the millennials, they, you know, sorry to say that, but even my children come in that category. So they are more addicted to phone. Now we see more younger and younger children wanting to have more of screen time. And our Indian Academy of Pediatrics has said that zero screen time for children up to 2 years, zero screen time, right? So for adults also, we need to restrict our screen time so that we will be able to sleep better, because sleep deprivation is a big, 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 big thing, which leads us to, if you are not sleeping well, then there is a big risk of developing heart attacks much earlier in life. This is also as bad as any other addiction, right? If you are sleep deprived, if you are not able to fall asleep before 12, then, you know, there is a much bigger risk of all these hormones up and down to happen and for us to have more health issues. Okay, so the other one is the social media addiction. So any of you who feels that I have to check the Facebook, I have to check the Instagram, I posted something, I want to see how many responses are there. So if the notifications ping, you see the bell and then you are like, I have to check immediately. It may be in the middle of the class, but you stealthily take the mobile and then you check your notification, to the extent that we are missing classes or we are not able to finish our assignments on time, because this works like a big distraction. So then we say it is addiction. You are using Facebook, Instagram, WhatsApp, everything, but it is not coming in the way of your study time. It is not coming in the way of your family time. You are able to take care of everything else, then we don't say it is addiction. So we say addiction only if it is causing all these problems. So you can always do something about it. So you can switch off the notifications or you can have set timings. Only this timing I will see. I won't keep it available at any time I can see, because once you start opening your Instagram account, you never know how time flies. The same doesn't happen when we pick up the book. After two lines, our eyes shut, right? After reading two lines, our eyes will start shutting down. But when the moment we open the Instagram account, even after 1 hour, you know, we are not aware that we think it is just 5 minutes, right? So this is something we need to be aware of. Food addiction, many of you have told about junk food addiction. Yes, junk food addiction also is a very big thing. So I want to quote one very small example. So I teach exercise for pregnant ladies, for new mothers. So one lady walks into my clinic. So she is wanting to learn exercises and other things. So when I discuss with her about whether she's having time for exercise, whether she's having healthy food, all these things. So then I get to understand that she has gained a lot of weight. So in pregnancy, you are allowed to gain so many kilos. So she has already gained in her 7th month, 15 kilos. So much more than what is permissible throughout her pregnancy. And whatever I say, you know, you need to eat fresh fruits or vegetables. She's looking at her mom like that. Then her mom says, see, she does not like to eat home-cooked food. She likes only junk food. So that is what she takes most of the time. So now this, I would say, is an addiction, because the growing needs of the baby cannot be met with the processed food. You know, it is more having all the bad things, like more sugar, more refined stuff, less of nourishment. Plus, there are a lot of additives, and all these food additives are linked to increasing risk of attention deficit hyperactivity disorder in children, increased risk of developing autism spectrum disorders. You know, these kind of problems are on the rise. The incidence of autism in India is 1 in 58 births. We never heard of autism 20, 25 years back. So it is all on the rise. And this lady, knowing pretty well, she knows, it is not that she does not know. She knows pretty well the importance of healthy eating. But during her pregnancy, at a very vulnerable time in her life, she is not able to control her urge to eat, you know, all junk food, and she is not able to eat healthy food. So this is not good. And eating is a habit. What we like is a habit. So from an earlier age, we start eating, you know, MACD and KYC and whatever, KFC and whatever we are eating, and we are so comfortable with that, then we develop dislike for home-cooked food. So it is very important that all these habits are formed in our earlier years, or, you know, we continue throughout our, you know, growth years or in our younger age, so that we will be able to switch to the right kind of food at the right time, right? So another addiction, this none of you had spoken about, this is addiction to stress. Do any of you have this? Waiting till the last moment. Tomorrow is the last date for submission. Tonight I will sit. Whole night I will write. I will see the Google everything, and then I will have several cups of coffee. That gives the thrill. Yes, you know, I'm not like you. I will not study early. Last 2 days, night out, and then everything is over. So this also gives that rush of dopamine. You know, whenever, you know, dopamine increases, we start feeling good. Stress can also give that, you know, high by increasing the dopamine levels. But at the same time, there are a lot of negative effects. BP is increasing, sugar levels are increasing. So that is also not good, right? And sometimes many of us may also think that if we scramble and then, you know, helter-skelter, we try to gather all the work and do, then we feel that I have done a lot of work. If we do in a relaxed pace, little at a time, you know, you feel it's not much fun. I don't feel that I have done something. So these are qualities which we have, which we enhance through this dopamine system, that even later on in life, if you have seen some of the, you know, at workplace also, there are people who are like, they are hyper when they have to do something. It appears they are doing a massive job. Just it's a small work, but they, you know, it is hyped up so much because that is the way they feel good. They feel that, yes, I'm doing something. So this is the addiction to stress. So there are, if you just stand outside a play school, if you see the mothers, there are so many mothers who will be like, oh, my child is doing that. He's doing so much masti. I put him in this class, that class. You know, he's so naughty. I'm just fed up of all these things. They crib and they talk as if there is a lot of work. And these are people who are more addicted to stress. So when things can be handled more easily, we unduly build up pressure within ourselves, which makes us feel that, you know, we are worthy of something. So this is a wrong sense of worth which we place on ourselves. And this can predispose us to health risk. Almost similar to, you know, smoking, alcohol, drug abuse, whatever happens with that, ill effects in health, social health, emotional health, same is applicable for stress. So don't think this is a healthy stress. This is equally bad. So, but these are silent addictions, which nobody notices or nobody tries to work on it. In fact, we are told that there should be some stress. Little bit of stress is okay so that we can work well. But if you feel that all the time you have to take stress to work, then we are multitasking. I'm doing cooking also. I am doing other work also. Then none of the work we do efficiently. and it will keep our heart racing all the time. You are never feeling at peace. This is not a good state to be. It can happen once in a while. If it is happening as a daily thing, then you need to work on it. Reduce your stress levels so that you have to de-addict yourself from these things also. Right? So we don't have de-addiction centers for, you know, junk food or for shopping or, you know, social media and all. But we need to work on it ourselves so that we can come out of these. Okay. Right. I think we have completed the addictions part. So if there are any questions, we can start taking them.
Yes, madam. There are a couple of questions in the chat box. Okay. The first question is by Husaina Nitrawala. She's asking, some people don't realize they're pregnant until 2 to 3 months. During these times, if they have consumed alcohol, how should they proceed ahead then?
Yeah, that is the reason why we want to not consume alcohol, you know, in the childbearing years. So, because it can happen that, you know, people who have irregular menstrual cycles, then they may not be aware. And the effect of when they go to the doctor, they will do the scans. So they will get to understand how the growth and development of the baby has been. So, but if there is questionable amount of alcohol which has been consumed, so then they may not continue with the pregnancy. Because of the harmful effects. So that is why even before you think of having a baby, it is better not to consume alcohol because of the ill effects. So it is better not to consume alcohol. I think that answers the question.
Yes, thank you, ma'am. Ma'am, second question is by Gunjan. She says, if a woman is consuming alcohol occasionally, what changes or health effects are associated in long time span? Ma'am, you have already answered this question when you were explaining the thing. Effects of alcohol on the body.
Effects of alcohol. So we have discussed that. So we will move to the other
question. Next question is by Ketki. She's asking, are there any ill effects in pregnancy if not the woman but her partner is alcoholic?
See, if the partner is alcoholic, so one thing would be that the quality of sperms can reduce. So it is not, the baby is not made only from the eggs. So, you know, part of the chromosomes, 50-50%, na? Out of the 46 chromosomes, 23 comes from the mother, 23 comes from the father. So we want to have good quality of the sperm. But one good thing about the sperms is that what was formed 1 month back is what came out today. Right? So if the man is not consuming alcohol for 2 months, then the sperm quality will be good.
Thank you, ma'am. Next question is by Soumya. She's asking, if a lady is smoking or taking alcohol, can it affect the possibility of pregnancy?
Yes. Yes, that is what we discussed, because it is going to affect the fertility, the quality of eggs. So it is both for men and women. So if you are a lady, you are not consuming alcohol, you are not smoking. If your husband is consuming alcohol, smoking, that can still affect the quality of the sperms. See, we want good progeny, right? So we want our children to be good. You know, in the genetic makeup has to be good. So, you know, both the partners' good health is very, very essential.
Ma'am, Fariha is asking, does alcohol damages women's body more than a man's body?
Exactly. It affects women's body much more. Man is consuming one big drink. Woman is consuming only one third. But the damage to the woman is much more for the same quantity of alcohol. Because of the way the woman's body is designed. See, women's body, the bones are also much tender, much softer. See, when we were reading anatomy in our college, we were told to identify the bones you know, whether it is a male bone or a female bone. So these markings used to be that the bones also, it is the genetic makeup. The male bones, they are much stronger, more robust. And the markings with the, you know, where the muscles are attached, they are very clear. In the women, the bones are much slender. They are more thin. You know, the markings are much softer. So the woman's body is genetically much more vulnerable to all these kinds of, you know, addictive substances. So here I wouldn't consider this as general equality. See, if a man getting addicted is madness, so the lady doing the same thing is double madness, because our body is much more vulnerable. So here I would say, please don't think about equality. So let us not consider he is also smoking, I will also smoke. My husband is drinking, I will give company. No. So then that is not the way it is going to work. See, our body will get damaged much more quickly.
Thank you very much, ma'am. Ma'am, this is another question by Barkha. She is asking, that means can't we smoke not even once a year?
In a party, once in a year, you smoke, it's okay. But let it not become a habit. So we discussed now with women, we can cling on to these things. When the stress increases, you may feel, let me have another puff. So, you know, genetically, we have the tendency to form attachments. So all this research is showing that with women, de-addiction is longer. It takes longer. And relapses are much more faster, you know, as compared to men. So why in the first place go to something which can drag you towards addiction? So if we can avoid that, that will be better. That is what I'm trying to say. It is not that there is nothing like one cigarette or two cigarettes. It is nothing to do like that. If you have that control, no, I won't be able to, I will not get into addiction. If you are very clear, we will say like that right now when everything is fine. So, you know, when we move towards addiction, we don't know.
There are a few more questions. Archana ma'am, should I go ahead?
Yeah, I think we have another 5 more minutes. It's 4:30, 4:35 tak we can go.
And then yes, Pallavi ma'am. Yeah, as Megham ma'am said, definitely.
Okay, there are a few more questions. You can take over, Archana ma'am. Have you?
Okay. Ma'am, the next question is on, in today's school system, there is an emphasis on using screens as teaching learning. How can we ensure that children do not get addicted to these tools?
Yeah, see right now, because of the online classes happening, so children, though we say that zero screen time for children, for young children, and after that also less screen time, now the school has come to the screen. So we find it a little difficult. So the way to go is keep the screen only for the purpose of education. After the session is over, to shut down the laptop and do other activities. Or the parent has to be there along with the child. Sometimes younger children, they are, you know, some educational video, some, you know, rhymes or songs or some games which are for brain development, whatever they say, it has to be with the parents. It cannot be alone. The child cannot be alone in the, you know, screen, because screen is so entertaining and so addictive. So if we as adults cannot stop ourselves, how do we expect young children to do it? So it has to be made a habit that they should go out and play. So here the parents' role is very important. We have to emphasize. Otherwise, if we simply complain that, nay, children don't listen, why they are going to listen? They will not listen. We have to emphasize.
Yeah. Ma'am, the next two questions I can club and ask. There is some, like you can say, a reaction also given. Ma'am, love the point of addiction to stress highlighted by you. I have people in my family who behave in such a way, and it's annoying at times, as they make us feel that we are not working hard. Is there any remedy for such a behavior? And the next thing is also like, how can we deal with addiction to stress? So both the questions are on the similar lines.
Yeah, yeah. It can happen. See, sometimes bullying. Bullying happens. And we usually think about bullying happening in schools, in colleges. You know, that is what is talked about more. But I always believe that parents are the biggest bully. Sometimes parents or, you know, siblings, it can happen. It can happen within the house. So one person's stress can get infectious, get contagious, spreads to the others, right? So what, you know, these are all just suggestions. We can just write out is that, see, stress can, you know, somebody can just, you know, push stress, you know, on us or throw stress everywhere. But it is for us to decide what we want to do, whether we want to take it in and also get stressed or protect ourselves, shield ourselves. So your response can sometimes help the other person to reduce their stress. I will say my own example, because sometimes as parents, we all do, I guess, sometimes I lose my cool and my son will be like, he will, you know, calm me down. He will give me a glass of water. I think you just need this. And I laugh at myself that, you know, it is not that parents only will teach the children, or, you know, it can be the other way around. Sometimes they work like a reflection board. They make us realize that we are showing stress. So, you know, these are all small things which we can do to our family members so that in a non-judgmental way, we are, you know, helping one another to keep the stress under control. See, that only tells that, see, if we shout back, then that is not the way to go. So we want it to be more comfortable for everyone in the house so that everybody's stress level will be low and everyone can function better. I hope that helped. Don't know.
Yes, ma'am. And I can say that maybe at times these are not intentionally done by anybody, the parents or even the other family members. They are so pressurized with something else and no,
exactly.
Unintentionally, yes. Unintentionally, these things pass on. But yeah. Yes, definitely, as you said, we need to practice and control this. Very right. Ma'am, the next question is, again, there are some remarks before the question. Ma'am, I agree that consuming alcohol isn't good for health. But in the book, Ikigai, there is mentioned that a lot of centenarians are women and they do consume a little amount of wine regularly. So maybe... Okay. Yeah, the participant wants your view on that.
Consumption of wine.
Yeah. Sometimes little.
See, alcohol, when they consume in, you know, in especially in some cold countries, they consume small quantities of beer or wine, you know, along with their food. So, you know, this is sometimes a cultural practice also in some places. When it is consumed to the point of intoxication, that is when, you know, it gives ill effects. So if you are consuming alcohol very little bit and you don't lose your balance, you are able to think clearly, you are able to talk clearly, so then, you know, you are not consuming excess. So like how we consume tea, coffee, like that, in some places, you know, in some countries, they consume, you know, it is part of their family meal. everybody consumes. All the adults in the family may consume, you know, small quantities of wine. So that is not addiction. So addiction is, as we discussed earlier, that when, you know, we are consuming more, right? So if you are consuming in a party, you are consuming large quantities, you are coming home drunk. So that is not good. So if it is very small quantity, it will not give that, you know, that kick. Right? So then it is not sufficient enough to damage your organs. So that will not cause you trouble. It will cause trouble if you are consuming more volumes. So the people who are consuming regularly and living long, so probably they are consuming very small quantities. Huh? So that is the difference. The quantity matters. So here, when they are taking, you know, alcohol in a party or something, so then there is no limit. And when you are consuming on empty stomach, that is a different thing. So all these things, there are so many factors which will influence how the blood levels of alcohols can increase. So and there are different opinions. So, but, you know, it is nothing like, it is not a, not that virtue, you know, like it is good, you know, morality. It is not like that. What we are discussing is only the health aspect. So the amount of alcohol which can cause injury to the body, that can vary depending on how you are consuming it. But when you are pregnant, you cannot take any amount of alcohol. So that is for sure. At other times, it can vary. But we don't want to go it to the point of addiction, or it cannot be to the point it can cause intoxication. That is when it can cause damage. Right?
Yes, ma'am. Yeah, anything in moderation is okay. But when it becomes excess, it can be anything. Even your beverages like tea.
Yes.
When you get addicted, that can also harm your body.
Harm your body.
Yes. If so, you don't have control over how many cups you have.
So even tea, coffee, everything, you know, we all take tea, coffee, we all take everything. So if you are taking 3 cups in a day, less than 3 cups in a day, it's fine. But if you are taking 10 cups in a day, then it is addiction.
Yes, ma'am. Rightly said. Ma'am, the next question is related to stress and the mood swings, which are usually experienced by women during the menopause period, after the menopause, or even during the menopause period, due to the hormonal imbalance that happens. So the participant wants to know how to deal with this.
See, menopause will bring about a lot of hormonal changes. So, you know, part of the hormonal changes will give mood fluctuations. But it is not compulsory for everyone. Everyone go through menopause in a different way. But how to manage that is, one, we need to exercise regularly, because when we exercise, our blood levels of dopamine, serotonin, endorphins all go up. So the feel-good factor is more. And we generally tend to reduce our activity level as we age. So if we reduce our activity, then we will not get the benefit of all these happy hormones in our system. So we will find it difficult in our menopause. So we have to exercise and we have to eat healthy. Being overweight, having health issues will add additional stress. There are so many ladies who at the age of 55 and all, they feel, I sacrifice my entire life for the family. I quit my job for my children. You know, I slogged all day long. I didn't have time for exercise. I bloated up like a balloon now. And see, my children are feeling thankless. They feel that, what did you do for me? See, these are all things which are working like triggers. So women tend to ignore our own health. You know, we always have this sacrificing image of women, right? So that has to change. You don't need to sacrifice anything. You take care of yourself. We have to take care of our health first. Only then we can take good care of our families. So little focus within. and then everything will change. So good exercise, good eating habits, and you know, taking proper care of our own self, loving your own self is what you need to do. So then everyone else will follow the same thing. You love yourself, everybody will love you. You have good respect for yourself, everybody will have good respect for you. So this is, then your mood will also change. You know, the self-worth, the feeling of self-worth will get better if you do something for yourself. So that is what we need to do so that we can manage our menopause much easily.
Yes, very rightly said, ma'am. Ma'am, as of now, the questions are not there. Maybe for this session, they are over. So,
okay. So next, we will move ahead.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, theek hai. So now, right, so we now spoke about all the addictions. So now we want to talk about wellness, right? So if you see in this picture, the woman's life from a small baby to the menopause, it is like a mountain. So now most of you are in the peak of your health. This 20 to 35 age group is the peak where we are having maximum strength, maximum energy, our bones are strong, we are all fit and fine. You know, this is the best or the peak of our health. So what we want to do is at different stages, we need to be able to take care of our life and, you know, ensure that our wellness is maintained. So especially when everything is at its best, we keep our health at the best, then, you know, you will be able to have a better bank balance. You know, if you imagine our health to be like a bank balance. So right now you want to earn more, put a lot of money in the bank, have a big fat balance. So when you retire, you want to have good amount of money, which will take care of you, right? So that is how we all plan. So the same way, you also take care of your health like that. You should have absolutely fantastic health right now, in the peak of your, life. So from 20 to 35, we should try and have absolutely good or the best possible health by doing all the right things, like how you gather money, how you earn money, like that you earn a lot of health right now, so that as we age, when our body is not very, very supportive, this good health which you stored in youth will be useful. Right? So that is what we need to look at. So the physical wellness, because first is physical wellness. When we are physically well, naturally we will be emotionally well. Then psychological aspect will also be good. Then social well-being will also be good. So if my health is not good, I'm having a lot of back pain. So then I'm going to be in a very irritable mood. Then I don't pay attention in the class, or I don't do my work properly. So I don't develop good relationship with others. So everything else is going to get affected. So physical wellness is priority one, and that is what we are going to discuss today, right? So in the physical wellness, the first thing, we are going to divide it into four aspects. So the first aspect being personal hygiene. So we want to ensure that we have good personal hygiene. So this is on menstrual health day, hygiene day. So this is put up by Kokilaben Hospital, that they have come out with this conclusion that 60% of women, they are able to change the pads only once in a day. And only 20% are able to have access to a toilet. So this is a very sad state. So menstrual hygiene, genital hygiene is very, very important for all women. And in the prime of our reproductive age, this is very, very important, right? So to have better menstrual hygiene, we should have access to all the hygiene products. So there are so many things which are available in the market. So, you know, like the sanitary pads are there. Now earlier there were cloth napkins which were used. So the hygiene was a concern, you know, to wash them properly and then dry them properly, you know, having a place where it is not seen by others. There were a lot of taboos associated with that. So now we have disposable sanitary pads, so which is much more hygienic, and you know it is much easier to use. But yes, there is a lot of landfills which are created because of that, because there is, it generates a lot of waste, and if it is not disposed properly, we can also spread infections. So you know, if there is a lady who has HIV or she has jaundice, so hepatitis B and all, which spreads through blood, if it is not properly disposed, sanitation worker who is coming in contact with the disposal can get infected. So proper disposal is important. Now these days you see other things, like you have these tampons, you have menstrual cups. So they are environment friendly. They are very convenient also. But you need to have very good standard of hygiene. So if you have to use tampons and menstrual cups, you should be able to have access to a clean bathroom where you can remove the tampons or the menstrual cups, because you have to put your hand inside the vagina to remove them. So which means you should wash your hands thoroughly before you put your hands, right? So if you are using a public lavatory, this may not be possible. A common lavatory, it may not be possible. So if it is your home environment where you have access to proper soap and all, then it is fine. And these menstrual cups needs to be removed. If the tampons get fully soaked, you should remove them immediately. If it is left inside, there are some girls who may use tampons also, and then they may use the sanitary pad also. Then it means that you are not removing the tampons on time. It can give rise to infections. So if you are using tampons, you should use only the tampon. If it gets completely soaked, then it is time for it to be removed. If you remove it on time, then it is safe to use. Because these things should not be left inside for long. It can cause very serious infections also. So if you can take extra care, you know, there are swimmers or athletes. These are the people right now who are using, or people who are wearing more of Western clothes, very tight fitting clothes, you know, models who are very body conscious. They may prefer to use tampons, menstrual cups. They are extremely good. They are very, very good. At the same time, you need to ensure that utmost cleanliness is followed. So you can use sanitary pads, you can use tampons and menstrual cups also. So these are the things which are most commonly used these days. And you can all just put it on the chat box. How do you think that if you are not following good menstrual hygiene, how it can affect our health? So why you think it is very important? Because there are so many girls who are not able to have access to clean toilets. So they may not change their sanitary pad. So they have the same sanitary pad throughout the school hours. You know, it need not be only with school children. Even in college, even in working places, women don't have access. You know, people who are like media people who are out most of the time, where they don't have access to toilets at all. So it is a big, health issue. So what do you think? What it can lead us to? Why it is important to ensure that we have good menstrual hygiene? Just put it on the chat box. Yes, infections, pain, clots. Correct, infections. Okay, V-wash is one such liquid to maintain hygiene conditions throughout, even in menstrual cycle. Is it okay to use it every day? No. So when you are during the menstrual cycle, it is recommended not to use soaps or V-wash on the private part. You should not use them. You should wash only with water. It can cause irritation of the skin. And these kind of medicated washes should not be used in the vaginal areas. So they are good on the ads, unless prescribed by your doctor. If you had some vaginal infection, the doctor told you to use it for a few days, then you can use it. Otherwise, the private part needs to be washed only with plain water. You will stop the use of soap at the groin. You know, where the thigh joins your body, you will use soap only up to there. You should not put it inside the private parts, inside the labial folds. You should not use soaps at all. No soaps or no medicated washes to be used. You will use only water. Yes, infection. Is it fine to use hair removal creams? No, no, no. No hair removal creams to be used in the private part. So if you have seen Anne French or Wheat, all these hair removal creams, they have mentioned specifically not to be used in the private part. If you want to remove the hair in the private part, you can either use a razor, or some people may like to use waxing also. That is all fine, but not to use hair removal creams. Infection is number one on the list of, the reproductive tract infections, which can be infection in the vagina. It can be infection of the cervix. If you are using tampons or, the she cups, all the menstrual cups which are inserted, there is a risk of introducing infection inside. So all these things which are inserted into the vagina, they can take the infection up to the cervix also. And it can cause infections in the uterus. It can cause infection in the fallopian tubes. It can cause pelvic inflammatory diseases. So which can be one important reason for infertility. Because the fallopian tubes with the infection, with repeated infection, they start getting sticky. Then they stick. So we know that the fallopian tubes is the tube through which the egg has to pass. The ovary is separate. The egg is released. It will be caught by the fallopian tubes. It has to come through the fallopian tubes, and the fertilization happens in the uterus. If the tube is not having the lumen, if it is sticking, then the eggs cannot come. So then fertilization doesn't happen. So repeated vaginal infections, uterine infections, fallopian tube infections, all the reproductive tract infection is related to poor menstrual hygiene. Because if the pad is soaked and it stays for more than 4 to 6 hours, then the infection can start passing, further inside the vagina, cervix, everywhere. So it is very, very important that we follow proper menstrual hygiene. Yes, the risk of cancer is also there, because repeated infection can alter the parenchyma. The cell can change under the influence of repeated infections. So that can give rise to cancers. Yes. It does not lead to gangrene usually. Manasa is asking, does it lead to gangrene? No. Usually gangrene doesn't happen. Gangrene is a very rare thing. So gangrene happens when the blood flow will also reduce. So that usually doesn't happen. Okay. Hot water, not necessary. Clean water, if you are during your periods, every time you use the washroom, it is important to wash our private area with plenty of water. Okay. Fine. I think questions.
Questions, ma'am, questions we will take later.
Right now, no questions. Okay. I'm just thinking about this. Okay. So the risk of not having proper menstrual hygiene is the risk of developing reproductive tract infections. Okay. So what do you think the hygiene practices which we need to follow during menstruations? So one thing we already discussed was that we need to wash that area with plain water. Every time you use the washroom, you need to wash with plain water. And when you have to touch the area, you know, if you have to change your sanitary pad, you have to wash, please wash your hands with soap and water before. We know that we have to do it after, but before you wash yourself on your private part, you have to wash your hands with soap and water. Okay. So there are other things also. You need to change the pads regularly. Every 4 to 6 hours, you need to change the pad. If the pad is soaked, then you don't wait. So you have to immediately change it. So sometimes if there are times when there can be over bleeding. So, you know, the pad got soaked within 2 to 3 hours. Don't hesitate. You have to change it, right? Because if it is more damp, then there is more likelihood of developing infection. More bacteria breed in that. Okay. And it is very important to take bath. So daily you have to take bath, especially in the periods. And if your dress is getting soiled, the underpants are getting soiled, you have to change them. So carry sanitary pad whenever you go out, so that, and you know, look for places where you can, you know, safely change and safely we can dispose the used sanitary pads. Right? Okay. Sometimes pain, discomfort can be there during menstrual cycle. So, you know, you can make use of yoga, simple yoga poses. Malasana is there, the Baddha Konasana is there, cobra poses are there. And just getting active during the menstrual period can reduce the pain. If it is severe pain, there are people who may, you know, have endometriosis or this kind of pain. They may require medical help. So they may need medication for pain relief. So those people should, you know, take the help of gynecologist, right? And it is also very important not to take medication to postpone periods just like that. I have a puja at home, so I will take, you know, hormonal pills, or I have, you know, doctor prescribed this medicine for, you know, my friend because sister's marriage is there, so we have to take that medicine. So I borrow that medicine from my friend and I take it. So this is again abuse, because when we are taking a lot of these hormones, it is going to see all these things, medicine which postpone the periods, these are the progesterone. The progesterone medication, what it does, it postpones the period, so the endometrium starts getting thicker and thicker. So after you stop the medication, when you start getting your periods, so there is going to be over bleeding. So then your iron stores will reduce, right? And it is going to disturb your hormonal balance. So it is not recommended to take any of these medications to postpone our menstrual cycle. Okay. So the next aspect which we are going to discuss. Oh, so I think here we have. Right. You're on track. Okay. Sorry. So the next aspect which we are going to discuss is about having strong pelvic area. So as women, we all know that, you know, we need to have good strength physically, mentally, because we are the ones who are going to have children, raise the children. So a lot of work related to women in the childbearing period. So the pelvic area is a very, important area where we need to focus emphasis on. So I want you to understand about this pelvic area. So we all know that, you know, the pelvic bone, you know, you can see this is the pelvic bone. So it is within this pelvic bone that our bladder, the bowel, the uterus, everything is located. So it is more like a bowl, like a basin. So the floor, the base of the pelvis, is called the pelvic floor. So that is a medical term we use, the pelvic floor, right? So if you see, it is made up of muscles. All the pink structures are all the muscles, the white structures are all the bone. So this is the pelvic bone, this is your spine, these are your legs, the thigh bones. So you can see this portion is the pelvic floor. So this This has the urine passage, vaginal passage, and the motion passage. All the three passages are there in the pelvic floor. Okay. So the muscles underneath, you know, these muscles, their job is multifold. They do a lot of work. So they support all the pelvic organs. They support the bladder. They support the uterus. And they also allow the urine to pass through, the motions to pass through, you know, for us to relax those muscles, for us to relieve ourselves. So for that also it is required. And whenever we have to pick up something, whenever we cough, sneeze, you know, we do some work, we are jumping, skipping, these muscles have to tighten. So prevents any urine from leaking, prevents the pelvic organs from slipping down, right? It has, and it also is part of the core muscles. So the abdomen, the pelvic floor, and the diaphragm, they all work together so that we can move our body in multiple ways for different functions very efficiently. During breathing, during, you know, when we are passing urine, when we are passing stools, when we have to lift weights, for all these different functions, the support from underneath is very important. So you can see that they are actually layers of muscles. And it is very important for us to work these pelvic floor muscles. So in yoga, this is also called Ashwini Mudra or Mool Bandh. So our forefathers have learned this 2000 or more years back, that these muscles are very, very, very important for women's health. Right? So now if you see if you search in the internet, you will see them as Kegel exercises. So these muscles are very, very important for us. So it has multiple functions, and these muscles are going to be stretched when the baby is delivered. In a vaginal birth, these muscles are also going to be stretched. So it is very common for women to have some dysfunction in this area, right? So I want to give you a little bit understanding about what kind of dysfunctions can happen, and so why we need to exercise. In younger girls who have, you know, sometimes you don't want to go to the washroom, so you keep on holding back the urge to urinate. What do? You tighten the muscles, right? You feel like, I want to use the washroom. No, now I cannot go. The washroom is so dirty. I pull it inside. So again, after some time, I have the urge, no, it is dirty, I don't want to go. So I pull it inside. So I keep doing that again and again. So 5 hours, 6 hours after I come back home, I use the washroom. So my muscles don't readily relax. They are like, oh, they are holding back. So this we call pelvic floor dyssynergia, means it is not able to coordinate the function of relaxing. Right? So this is one end of the spectrum, the pelvic floor dysfunction. On the other end, with childbirth, you know, or with obesity, we are doing a lot of heavy lifting work. So then the muscles have become weak. We already discussed the muscle gets stretched during birth. So the muscles are weak. We have not done any exercise to that muscles. So it is very weak, so it causes incontinence. When I cough, sneeze, urine is leaking. So this is the other end of the spectrum. So we need to be aware that we have a pelvic floor, and we need to keep that in good health. So keeping that in good health means first being aware of the pelvic floor and then doing some exercise to it regularly. So now let us take out 2 minutes. We are going to learn how to develop this awareness and do some exercise for this area, right? So are you all ready? So you just need to be sitting upright. So wherever you're sitting, if you're sitting on the floor, you can sit cross-legged. If you're sitting on the chair, just sit with your back straight. Okay? So what you need to do, we first need to think of the area down below. So if you are sitting down, just feel the contact of your private part on the seat. Now, wherever you are sitting, on the cushion, you can feel, yes, my vaginal area is coming in contact. So just register that sensation. Okay. So now what we are going to do, you think of your urine passage or your vaginal passage, whichever you feel is easier to visualize. Try to squeeze that area. To think of squeezing, you think, I want to pass urine. No, I don't want to. Just squeeze it inside. You want to hold back passing urine, so you squeeze it inside. Now, relax it. Just let it go. You could feel that you squeezed the muscle there and then you relaxed it. So if you can feel that, yes, I could feel that I squeezed the muscle. Yes, now I relax the muscle. So then you are aware of that area. You think about the anal passage, the motion passage. You think you want to squeeze it inside as if you want to stop wind. You don't want to pass any gas. So just pull it inside. Now relax it. You can feel that, you know, it is moving slightly up into your body. And then you relax as if you are just dropping it back. Right? You can try doing it one more time. Try doing it for the urine passage. Try to pull it inside and relax it. The same way, try to pull the motion passage inside and relax it. Okay? So this, if you are able to feel that I am pulling something inside, I feel something is there moving up, then you are aware of your pelvic floor muscles. So the exercise is also the same. We are going to just try to squeeze the urine passage, relax it. Squeeze the motion passage, relax it. Sometimes it can so happen, you are not able to differentiate. I think of urine passage, motion passage is also going up. I think of motion passage, urine passage is also going up. We may not be able to differentiate. That is fine. When we are beginning the exercise, we may not be able to differentiate. But if you are able to feel at least something there, either this or that is going up, that is good. Right? So what we need to do, we will do just 3 repetitions. Now you try, we will all do it together. Try to squeeze the urine passage up and relax. Leave it. Give a little pause. Now again we will repeat. Pull it inside and relax. One more time. Squeeze your urine passage in. Now relax. Now we are going to try the anal passage. Now try to squeeze the anal passage in and relax. Again, squeeze inside. Relax. Again, squeeze inside. And relax. So that's it. It's such a simple exercise to do. Right? So the only thing is that we should have that awareness. Some ladies may feel that I don't feel anything. I don't feel anything moving up. Means we are not so aware of the pelvic floor function. It is not that the muscle is not working. The muscle is working well, but we are not aware. So slowly as we do the exercise, you can even use a hand mirror. Look at your private part when you're trying to do the exercise. So then you will understand, you know, what is happening. Or another way is when you are passing urine, just stop. You can feel that immediately the urine flow stops. So what happened? You squeezed your pelvic floor muscles, the urine flow stopped. Right? So this you will do only to understand. You will never do the pelvic floor exercise in the washroom. right? Pelvic floor exercise should not be done in the washroom. It has to be done when you're sitting, when you're standing, when you're walking, anytime you can do. And at a stretch, you can do say 5 or 10 repetitions. It can be repeated 2-3 times in a day. So then we will develop more awareness, more strength in the pelvic floor muscles, right? Okay. So another important exercise which we need to do is the core muscle activation. So now we get to hear more about core muscle strength. You know, you see all celebrities' videos. So they are doing their planks and, you know, they are doing, they are doing hanging exercises. They use the wall ladders. You know, so many different kinds of exercise. Now we are much more aware of the core muscles. So what this core muscle means? So you can see this picture. You can see this soda can, right? So the core muscle is literally like a can. What I mean by being like a can is that, so the muscles are lining the inside of our belly and chest, means from the diaphragm to the pelvic floor. So you can see the top is the diaphragm, bottom is the pelvic floor. This is the top lid, this is the bottom lid. In the front, it is the deep belly muscles, and back, it is the deep back muscles. So it forms a like a canister, like a can. So this sheath of muscles gives protection whenever we are moving. Now, more and more younger people who have to do a lot of desk work, they complain of back pain. The reason being, when we are sitting for too long, these core muscles, that, you know, the especially the pelvic floor, the abdominal muscles, and the deep back muscles, they forget their job. They forget their job because when we are sitting relaxed like that, nicely comfortable, you know, on the PC, on the laptop, with the laptop on the lap, then our muscles are not triggered to work. And these core muscles are supposed to work in the background, not when we are doing only exercise. Even when we are just sitting, when we are standing, these core muscles are supposed to work. That is how they give protection to the back, prevents back injuries. It gives protection to the pelvic floor and the pelvic organs. So when we pick up something heavy, it will not cause prolapse. When we do exercise, it should not cause prolapse or cause leaking of urine. So all these things are functions of the core, right? So if it is getting a little overwhelming, it's okay. You just understand that these core muscles are lining the inside wall of our body, and they are the ones which are protecting us from back injuries. And these muscles will get weaker if you are sitting for prolonged periods. So the first step is you should not sit for long periods of time. So you sit for long period, the core muscle is going to get weaker. And to activate the core muscle is not a big rocket science. You can activate them easily through our breathing exercise. Here again, the age-old yoga. So in yoga, there is a lot of focus on prolonged exhalation, like how we do the Om chanting, right? So if we do the Om chanting, if we say a long Om, your belly muscles slowly start moving inwards. So this is the activation of core. So if you want to activate your core, if you can chant Om 10 times, or you can do long exhalation, like you do, as long an exhalation as is possible, you're beginning to activate your core. Right? So that is the easiest exercise you can think of. Then, of course, you can do the planks also. So these are all good exercises which any beginner can start with. So we need to do this. See, in our culture, the thin people don't get to do any exercise, right? So people who are slightly on the heavier side, everybody will tell them, you should now exercise, you should exercise. But thin people, nobody will tell them to exercise. You don't need to do anything. You are thin, right? So all the lean people are not exercising in our country. The people who go to the gym, most of them are people who are trying to lose weight. So it's a wrong concept. All of us should exercise for our wellness. So on core muscle is the first exercise we need to begin. Then whatever exercise we do, it will not injure your body. If we have to exercise without causing injury, we need to start by exercising your core muscles. Okay? Right. So the next thing is going to be about preventing some of the health issues. So some of the common health issues which are there in women. So these are the health issues which are not spoken about much. See, some health issues are spoken about. Right, so when it comes to cancer, pap smears, and you know, regular checkup, everybody talks about that. Right, so when it comes to diabetes, hypertension, everybody talks about that. But have you heard of people talking about incontinence? Do you know what is incontinence? Does any of you? You can just put it in the chat.
No, ma'am. I think the reply is no.
No, yes. So because this is something we are not familiar with. So that is why I chose to talk about those things which we are not generally aware of. You know, these are not the things which are spoken about. So I want to talk about this incontinence, pelvic organ prolapse, and abdominal muscle wall weakness. So this is very common. Very common. Do you know that out of three women, if you see three women, one will have incontinence? It is so prevalent. And women are simply suffering in silence. So incontinence can be within our home, our mom, our sister, our, you know, aunt, grandmother, any of them can have incontinence. Right? But they don't talk about it. Incontinence is nothing but when we cough, sneeze, or laugh, if we are leaking urine, feces, gas, then that is incontinence. Out of which, urinary incontinence is the most prevalent. Most prevalent. And especially, it is much more prevalent after childbirth. And it is much more prevalent as women age. And the sad thing is, most aging women accept this as part of aging. They think that, no, I don't have any problem. Just, I'm aging, no, that is why I have these things. So, aging will not give you incontinence. Weak pelvic floor muscles will give you. So, if when you cough, sneeze, when you laugh, if you feel that, you know, I'm leaking urine or I'm not able to dance, I like aerobics, I'm not able to go for aerobics, I like Zumba, but I don't go to the class because I leak urine. You have to give up your favorite hobby, favorite sport. Then it means that you need to take help. You need to work your pelvic floor muscles. It's very, very important. Okay. So the other one is pelvic organ prolapse. We will talk about that also. So, but first, I will also want to give you some information about healthy bladder habits. You know, all this incontinence happens because of the pelvic floor weakness. And there are other issues in the bladder, you know, bladder health, which happens because of the pelvic floor issues only. Like, the pelvic floor being too tight or the pelvic floor being too loose, right? So that forms the foundation for our healthy bladder. So let us have a small quiz on this. Archana ma'am, happening?
I put the link in the chat box. Participants, you can access it through the chat box. Give me a minute.
Okay. I think we may overshoot the time by 15 minutes.
It's okay, Nigam ma'am.
Is that fine?
Yeah,
don't worry. We can ask the participants also if they are fine with that.
Okay. Participants, you can quickly access the quiz. And Nigam ma'am, 3 questions I was able to put in the quiz. 3 questions okay. We will have to take up in the chat box.
Okay? No problem.
So for that, I'll be typing it later in the chat box. First, I'll see what is the response for this quiz. Participants, just wanted to know if you all are able to access just a thumbs up or a yes in the chat box, anything. Okay.
Is this enough time for completing the quiz?
Yes, I think ma'am, most of them have done it. I'll just quickly orally share with you, Nigam ma'am, what will be responses for it. The question, 1 minute, I'll just go back to the question and read it. Yes, the first question, ma'am, was about
someone says unable to open the link.
Okay, we will just discuss the questions later since we already have many responses here. Ma'am, the first question was, is it healthy habit to use washroom before we are going out, even though we not feel full in bladder. Okay. Now, here we have a response of 50-50%, ma'am. Some say yes, it is a healthy habit, and some say it is not.
Okay.
Second is, when using public toilets, do you sit on the toilet seat? Here, most of them have given the response as no.
Okay.
And the third was, when you are in haste, do you give time to completely empty the bladder? Here also, ma'am, again, we have the response of 50-50%. Some say yes and some are saying no.
Okay. Okay. Theek hai. Okay. So we will take up the answers for each one of them. So the first one is, before you go out, whether you should use the washroom.
Yes.
So this we call just in case. You know, my bladder is not full, but before I go out, just in case, let me empty the bladder. So this we say as wrong bladder training. So when the bladder is not full, we start going to the washroom at smaller bladder volumes. So we are training the bladder to give us signals for smaller volumes. So this can lead us to frequent trips to the washroom. You know, during the lockdown, many people said that they are sitting at home and working. Because the washroom is accessible, they are going every 1 hour. So this is not good. The bladder has the capacity to take up 350 ml. So before it should, at least a 250 ml, it will give the first signal of wanting to pass urine. If we start going to the washroom very frequently and just in case, before I go out, before I come back, before I go take the bus, for many things, before I sit for the talk. So this results in the bladder giving us signals when it is just 50 ml, 100 ml, right? So this is bladder training. So we have to train the bladder to fill up sufficiently before we go to the washroom. A good length of time will be good 2 hours. 2 to 4 hours gap can be there. You don't need to rush to the washroom every 1 hour. So allow the bladder to fill up. Right? So that is
So that practice is not good.
Good. Yes. Okay. So we are not saying that you should hold back urine. This is not holding back urine. You know, just in case, you know, even like, I don't feel full, but because we have to go out, let me urinate. So this trains the bladder poorly, that it gives signals frequently. Then we end up wanting to pass urine many times in a day. So that is bad. And the second thing, when in public toilets, when we go out, whether you need to sit. See, if you are a working person, and 8 hours, 10 hours a day, you are outside, you have to use toilets which are not your own toilets. If you don't sit on the toilet seat, what is the problem? Then our pelvic floor muscles cannot relax. So if they don't relax, then we cannot empty the bladder fully. If you don't empty the bladder fully, there can be residual volume. Already, bladder, you cannot empty to the last drop. There can be 5 ml of urine which can be there. Right? But if you hover over the toilet seat and not sit on the toilet seat, then you will not empty the bladder fully. This can result in urinary tract infections. And it can also cause pelvic floor dysfunction, where you may have to strain to urinate because your pelvic floor is tight. When it has to relax and allow the urine to come out, it is actually tight. So this is something to avoid. So how you can avoid that? Either choose an Indian toilet, so you don't need to sit on the seat. Right? Otherwise, you sit on the seat. That's okay. And then you can use a tissue to wipe your skin, right? That is much better than having urinary tract infection repeatedly, which can lead to bladder infection. It can ascend to the kidneys. So that is not good. So that we need to avoid. Okay.
Yes, ma'am. The third question was, when you are in a haste, do you completely relieve yourself? Do you do that?
Yes.
So again, here, it was 50-50% vote. Some say yes and some say no.
Yes. So the ones who are not relieving, the bladder completely, you need to now work on it. Because when we are in haste, this is the time we may try to put pressure to urinate, forcefully urinate, or halfway through, okay, finished, and then you want to just get up and rush. So if this becomes a practice, there can be residual urine, risk of urinary tract infection. And here again, we are not completely relaxing the pelvic floor muscles, and we need to give time for the bladder to empty. If the bladder is too full, it takes time to get emptied. We need to give time for emptying. So on all of those who are allowing, who are able to completely empty the bladder, kudos to you, because you are doing good. So then the chances of urinary tract infection will reduce. So should we take the other three questions also now?
Yes, should I just, ma'am, if you allow, I will do the screen share for the questions. They can see it on the PowerPoint, and they can quickly put the on this on the chat.
Absolutely.
Box. Yeah. So you will have to stop the screen share, ma'am.
Okay. Or should I ask them, and will they be able to put it?
Okay, no problem. Even
so that we can save time.
Yes, yes. Those are small questions.
Yeah. So one question, first question is, how many times is it okay to visit the washroom in the daytime? How many times can you visit the washroom in a day? Two times? Four times? Four to five times?
Yeah, I have put the question in the chat box. Yeah, we are receiving the responses.
Two to four times, three to five times, above four, eight to ten times. 8 to 10 times is more. Good. Majority of you are saying correctly. So it is 4 to 6 times.
Okay.
So on an average, you use the washroom every 2 to 4 hours in the waking hours. So 4 to 6 times. Summer it can be less, winter it can be little more. Okay. And how many times it is okay to visit the washroom in the night?
I have put that question also, ma'am.
Yes.
In the chat.
One, twice, zero to one. Yes. So Pearl has said it correctly, 0 to 1. So you need not get up in the night to go to the washroom. So if at all you have to get up to use the washroom, it can be just once, not more than that. Okay.
Third question. Yeah.
So do you feel embarrassed by the noise of the stream of urine? So when we pass urine, there is a noise. So do you feel embarrassed? If you feel embarrassed, what do you do about it?
Good. Their writing is no.
No.
The response.
Good.
But
yes.
I feel, yeah.
Yes. Somebody is saying yes. Yes. Yes.
Yes.
Yes. Sometimes. Yes. Sometimes in public. Yes. Yes. Sometimes. So what do you do? Please mention that. What do you do? You feel embarrassed by the noise of the urine stream. So what do you do? Yes, you make the tap on.
Sometimes they have written.
Turn on the flush. Flush so the noise will subside. Yes. Use the flush. Turn on the water tap. Hold on to the pressure and try to regulate the flow. Yes. So is Roshni, you have there on the right, this thing.
Okay.
See, push the pelvic area in and manipulate the speed of urine. Yes. So see, these are the things which we should avoid. Many of us do that. Push the pelvic area in, manipulate the speed of urine and holding back and try to regulate the flow. So this is where we are pulling our pelvic floor. At that time when we have to relax the pelvic floor, we are trying to pull it inside. So this is more common in younger women. Younger women feel easily embarrassed, right? So because of the stream of urine. So if you feel that you hear the noise of the, you know, urine stream, you should say, yes, my bladder is working great. Right? That means your bladder is able to give good pressure to empty the, you know, empty the urine. So that is a very good sign that the bladder is working well. So when you see a big stream of urine, don't try to pull it inside and make the stream small. This later on can lead us towards, you know, pelvic floor dysfunctions. Right? So that is what I wanted to, you know, bring forth. Ki, you know, these are all things we do. We do feel embarrassed with, you know, the stream of urine, the noise, and then we do try to control that and how this can affect us. Because working women, professional women spend most of their time outside the home. So if we do that on a daily basis, it is going to have an influence on our long-term health. So please don't do that. Okay. All right. So we'll take the questions later on, right? So I'll see the questions, but I'm not answering them right now.
Okay. But ma'am, I feel most of the questions you have already answered through your talk. Just okay. One or two which are different, we will take back.
Okay. Okay. So the daily, the toilet habits, so we have already discussed the answer. So that is what is put in here. So we will not go back to that. And what is the sign of poor bladder habit? So we have discussed this already. Just in case washroom, if you are going, we have to stop that. And if you are using, if you are do this habit of holding back urine, then with time, this is what happens. We have trouble starting our stream of urine. We have trouble, and so we strain to pass urine. And instead of the urine stream moving continuously, we hold back and then we relax, hold back, relax. All these patterns emerge. So don't have this hesitation. Just let the urine stream come out. Feel that my bladder is healthy today. You know, that is what your bladder is saying aloud. See, I'm healthy. I'm doing my work. So you have to feel good about it, proud about your bladder, not feel ashamed, not to feel shy, right? And the bladder should be completely emptied by giving sufficient time. You wait. It can take a little long. On some days, your bladder empties in 30 seconds. Some days it takes a minute. Sometimes it takes 2 minutes. It's okay. Give that time and allow the bladder to empty fully. We have already discussed about the pelvic floor weakness. So for the bowels, so like how, see, bladder is much more tricky. We have more doubts with the bladder habits. Bowel, usually it is more straight and simple. We all know that we need to avoid constipation and we need to not strain when you are using the bowels, because chronic constipation is one reason for pelvic organ prolapse. So as a young person, you know, if I'm getting constipated and every time I'm straining for stools, I may not understand the significance right now, but it can make my tissues on the pelvic floor very slack. After childbirth or when I get little overweight, it can make me more vulnerable for prolapse, right? And eating good amount of fruits, vegetables, and being physically active is essential to keep our bowels in good condition. Okay. So when you need to take medical help, when you have signs of urinary infection, when there is urgency, when you are, there is more frequency in the night time, these could all be signs of urinary infection, burning urination, or any pain, pricking pain, or, you know, fever, pelvic pain. These could all be signs of urinary infection where you will take medical help. But the first thing is prevention. If you have your proper bladder hygiene, if you have proper genital hygiene, and if you wash your private part always front to back, not the other way around, the fecal matter should never come in contact with the urinary passage, then chances of getting recurrent urinary infections reduce. So simple basic hygiene. So when you're taking bath, you have to, you know, wash your private part only with water. And after your pass stools, you wash from front to back, not back to front. So this we need to remember so that recurrent urinary infections don't develop. So the other one is about the pelvic organ prolapse. So what is pelvic organ prolapse? So you can see this is the normal female pelvic organ location. Now it is like a bowl. So the in the front, there is the bladder. In the middle is the uterus. And behind, there is the bowel. So because of obesity, because of constipation, because of childbirth, repeated childbirth, or injury to the pelvic floor muscles at the time of birth, it can prolapse down. So, you know, uterine prolapse, it is called. Sometimes it is, you know, there is, you, some women, they may feel there is a pressure down. For some women, the uterus can literally be dangling out like a ball. When they sit, they, you know, that is all third degree prolapse, which requires surgery. So first and second degree prolapse, when it is slightly coming down, many people are not aware. And if you are not doing exercise, then we may not be aware. You know, you should do your pelvic floor exercise regularly so that you can avoid pelvic organ prolapse. And the way to prevent the pelvic organ prolapse is to exercise your pelvic floor muscles regularly and control abdominal obesity. See, these days, we also see women who are overweight, especially on the belly. So when there is more belly fat, that also put a lot of pressure on the pelvic organs. So even if you are not constipated regularly, even if you did not have a vaginal birth or you did not injure your pelvic floor muscles, this abdominal obesity can cause prolapse, especially women who are very huge BMI, like more than 25, 30, you know, more than 30 BMI, there is big risk of developing pelvic organ prolapse and incontinence also, right? So chronic cough, constipation, if these things are there, you need to treat that. And women, that is why in age old, you know, maybe your mom, your grandmom, they say that women should not do very hard work. This is the reason. If you pick up very heavy weights, it can put a lot of pressure on the pelvic floor muscles. It, they may give up and it may give rise to prolapse. So the, usually it happens Diwali time. I did a lot of cleaning. I picked up a lot of furniture. I pushed cupboards. And then after that, you know, they visit the gynecologist and they find that, oh, I have a prolapse. Right? So it is better to avoid all those things, because when the prolapse is more than the only in the initial stages, exercises will work. If it is very severe, then it has to be TVT, they say, tension-free vaginal taping. They do taping. And if it is very severe, then the uterus needs to be removed. They have to do a repair of that area. So, you know, it is better to avoid those kind of interventions. The other one is about the abdominal muscles. So we all like a nice toned up flat belly muscle, right? So nice flat belly is a dream for every girl. So we would like to flaunt our waistline. We would like to flaunt our navel, everything. But we tend to lose the, you know, the integrity of the belly muscles sooner with abdominal weight gain, with pregnancy, with childbirth. The abdominal muscles can become very slack. So it is very, very important that we need to exercise regularly, especially the abdominal muscles. Can we take the last 5 minutes? I will show the abdominal muscle exercises. And then after that, one more slide only, and then we should be able to wrap up. Is that fine?
Yes, ma'am. Yeah, definitely.
Okay.
So, participants, yeah, what I would request.
Are they fine?
Most of the questions have been answered. Some are little personal questions which you have put. Can you just forward it to me and Pallavi ma'am on the WhatsApp or on the WhatsApp group which we have created for this particular workshop, so that we forward it to Nigam madam and then the reply, y'all can get it through that. Okay?
Yeah.
Yes, Nigam ma'am.
Okay. Yeah. We are going to do some abdominal exercise in the standing position. So I'm just going to show you 2-3 exercises which we can easily do. So if all of you can be, you know, whoever wants to do the exercise can be in the standing position. So you can also do it along with me. So one simple thing is to keep the belly gently inside. You know, instead of leaving the belly muscles loose, keep the belly gently inside. So when you are doing this, there should be no breath holding. You know, gently inside. So this is a good way to engage the core. So this is a good beginning one. And from here, we can do simple things like one leg up. So if you want to see the leg position, so I'm just standing one leg up and down. So if you want, you can do alternate leg up and down. And we can also move the arms along with that. Another variation we can do to the same thing is you pick up one leg and then you can twist your body a little bit. Pick up one leg, twist your body little bit. So this will give you more balance. Your hip muscles will also work and your belly muscles will also work. And for the sides, you know, many times we are bothered about the love handles. So you can do this side bends. Side bends. So if you want to make it little more challenging, you can do 1, 2, 3, 4 on one side, and you can avoid touching the floor, like 1, 2, 3, 4. So which puts more demand on the abdominal muscles, right? Or if it is difficult, you can do one at a time, like that, side bends, right? One more exercise to do is from the pelvis. So we need to move the leg. So you take one leg in the air and then you can just drop the pelvis. So it is going to be like, you know, these are some of the moves which they use in belly dance. So where you drop the pelvis, drop, lift, drop, lift. This leg is not touching the floor. It is in air. So you just drop the pelvis and height the pelvis. So you can do it on the other leg also. Drop the pelvis and you can also height the pelvis. Right? So these are all some simple exercises which we can do to keep our belly muscles in good condition. And
to keep our belly muscles from getting overstretched, it is very, very important to exercise right now in our pregnancy and after delivery and as we age. You know, when you are reaching menopause, don't think that we have to stop exercise. We have to be regular with the abdominal exercises also, so that there is no age limit. That, you know, there are many people who ask me, so after delivery, till 2 years, the belly muscles will go inside. After that, it won't become flat. Nothing like that. Whenever we are regular with our exercise, we can build up more strength in the muscles and we will be able to get fitter. So these are some of the abdominal exercises to do. The last part is about how we need to have stronger bones and muscles. So the answer is very simple. We all need to be exercising. So this is WHO statement. So WHO has given, the recommendation for everyone that 60 minutes of physical activity daily is important for better health. So if you 60 minutes of physical activity means you should be having either brisk walking, some exercise. So, you know, those kind of activities. And out of that, 30 minutes should be moderate intensity, that you are panting for breath.
So apna cooking or cleaning, nothing comes in that. So we are not engaging in that intense physical activity. That much amount of physical activity is very, very essential. And we all need good sunshine. Sunshine is, you know, very rich in vitamin D. And India being a tropical country, most of us are suffering from vitamin D deficiency because we are all remaining indoor. We are in AC rooms. So we are working indoors. So we are getting deficient in vitamin D. Vitamin D is essential for healthy bones. So we have to go out in the sun. So forget the sunscreens. So don't use the sunscreen and try and take some sunlight. Right? So it's okay to get a little dark, but your bones will become stronger. And we need to eat a healthy meal. So this is roughly how the meals should be. Like if you take a round plate, cut it into half. One half should be your cooked and uncooked vegetables. That is, cooked vegetable is 25% and the other quarter should be uncooked vegetables. So salads and cooked vegetables. So half of your plate is filled with vegetables. The other half you divide into two portions. One portion is your rice, roti, carbohydrate. The other portion should be your proteins. So it can be your dal, pulses, milk, curd, everything. So if you have this kind of a meal pattern, we will not gain too much weight and, you know, we will be able to stay healthy for all the future years. And to top it all, we all have to value ourselves, love ourselves and give time to ourselves, be it for taking up a small hobby or just sitting at the window side to sip your hot cup of tea. Or giving time to learn something. So don't be very harsh on yourself, right? We all need time to learn, time to do things in our way. So be kind to yourself. That is very important. We have to be kind to ourselves. Only then we can show kindness to others. And having a positive attitude. And then that's it. So I think we have overshot by 25 minutes. I'm so sorry about that.
No, it's okay, ma'am. Yeah. Over to you, Pallavi, ma'am.
Nikumaja, ma'am, it was amazing, amazing. Everybody was there throughout. Nobody wanted to leave. So many times, though, you said you ask the participants, but they were too engaged in the talk that nobody was thinking of leaving the class. So let me thank you for being here with us. Ma'am, women's health need to be in front and in center all the time. But often it isn't. We never think about our health, but then it's essential to be thinking. We need to think about that. And today with your session, you have focused on this point that, of course, everybody need to be there. You need to take care of your health. And ma'am, as you said, all our girls are in peak of their health. And their health is their capital. And they need to now take care of this capital. So everybody had many questions in their mind. Many times it so happened that it becomes difficult to ask a question to a parent or there is a conflict whom to ask, whom to approach. Okay, for the small queries in their mind, they can't approach even doctor. So they were very happy to share so many questions. So our chat box was full of questions, all the personal questions they were having related to the matters that you have shared. And ma'am, the way beautifully you have handled all the questions and all their queries are solved, I think right now they all are in the position to take care of their health in such a nice manner that, of course, as you said, the next generation is going to be healthier now. So, ma'am, we are really, really fortunate enough to have you here for this session. The way you explained the things, it was not just theory. It was theory plus practicum. At the same time, you have explained all the things in a simple, beautiful manner. So, no jargon of terms when while explaining the things. So, you reach to our hearts, you reach to ours, and then everybody could understand all those minute details that you have provided to us. There are a lot of polls, questions in between. So throughout, all our participants were engaged in the whole thing. So ma'am, we are really, really fortunate to have you here. And as you said, at the end of the day, as you focused here, your health is your responsibility. And therefore, absolutely, each one of us need to know how to take care of ourselves. So ma'am, on behalf of Gujarat Research Society, our principal, Dr. Anita Swami, staff members, our students, and all the participants for the workshop, I extend a heartfelt gratitude to you, ma'am, for being here with us and sharing your knowledge with us, and of course, solving all the queries that we had in our mind. From your busy schedule, you could take out some time for us and be here with us, ma'am. It was really grateful to you. So thank you very much, ma'am, for conducting this workshop for all our girls. And of course, ma'am, we are not going to leave you like this. As Archana ma'am already said, we are going to send you the questions, which some of the questions we could not handle here.
I'm so sorry we had to extend the time. So I'm very sorry about that. So I am also very thankful to all of you for, you know, patiently being there. And, you know, it is nice to interact with so many of you. And thanks to you, Archana ma'am and Pallavi ma'am, for being there throughout, supporting me all the while. So you are great help. Thank you. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, ma'am.
Yeah, can you stop the screen share?
Yeah, screen share.
Yeah.
Stop screen share.
And thank you all the participants to being here with us and making this session more interactive by posing your questions and participating in all the activities that Nikita ma'am has organized for you. So thank you very much for being here with us.
Students, can we have you on the video mode and unmute and upload for Nikam madam session today, everyone?
Yeah, everyone, come on video.
Yes, please. At least those who can, please. Ma'am, this is
in
for you.
Yourself.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you so much, ma'am. And we end this seminar here. Of course, Pallavi ma'am, I want to talk to FI students for 5 minutes. Rest, yeah, you may